So if you let me, okay, so you, I guess you are last week. I'm supposed to take the first class, but I couldn't. Sorry for that. So some of you at least must have seen the course contents in your syllabus book, in your JNTU Kakinada syllabus book. So basically for this course, we will be having four lectures per week, Tuesday 2 and Thursday 2. And I'll be this course mainly I'll be following the two books which I would like to list here, so that you can, if you can borrow it from your libraries, and or if you want you can buy it. They are all low cost editions, like 300 rupees or so. So the textbooks we'll be using for this course are the following. We'll be using a mixture of these two books. So Signals and Systems, by Oppenheim. And Wilsky. Okay, so this is second edition. Will be I'll be I like this book very much. I'll be mainly following this book, but for some topics we will also be using another book, which is Signals and Systems, with the same title, but it is by Simon Hakin. HAYKIN and Barry Van Veen. So this is also second edition, right? So you can find both these books in any of these standard bookshops, or you can find it on Flipkart or Amazon, whatever. And your library must be having, all of your college libraries will be having copies of these books. These are pretty standard books, right? I just would like to say, introduce myself. My name is K.V. Srinivas. I work in this IIT Varanasi, and in case, see, if you have any specific doubts or any important questions, then you can mail me at this. This is my mail ID. Right, so you mail me only if you have or some concern, that some feedback about the course, how it is going, is it too fast or too slow, or if you are finding any particular difficulty with respect to the course, then you can mail at this mail ID. This is my mail ID. Sorry. Right. And last semester we were having a WhatsApp group. JNTUK technical staff Mr. Asgar has created a WhatsApp group. So like that, I request somebody else. Like, okay, so you must have noticed, noted my email ID. And then I found, like, last time when I taught, I could not share the class notes. Sorry, here there is Oppenheim. There is a spelling mistake in this Oppenheim and Wilsky. Yeah, so this time I will try to save this, my electronic notes, whatever I'm writing here, I will try to save it as a PDF. So I found a way how to save it as a PDF, and then I can mail it to somebody in JNTUK so that they can distribute it to you at a later date. But I seriously request all the students to take notes while listening to the class, so that way you will get more out of the class, right? And one more thing I request is the following. Okay, so this week we can talk about it later. So let's start with this course, which is Signals and Systems. As all of you are in second year, you must have done some basic electronics courses in your first year. Like you must have come across signals as such, like current signal, voltage signal, DC, AC, power signal, energy signal, whatever, right? Like, yeah, so many different kinds of signals you must have come across. Use the course, like what the course is about, what you are supposed to learn, what we will be discussing throughout this course, and then we will start with the basic basic definitions, right? So let us start with the definition of a signal. Okay, so maybe before this, before writing a formal definition of a signal, what could be the example of a signal and system, right? So if you think about your daily life, say when you are traveling on a road, or mainly when you are traveling on a scooter or an automobile, you will come across obviously traffic signals, right? So traffic signal is also an example of a signal. When we say signal, it need not be only an electric signal, or it need not be only a voltage signal or a current signal. So what is a traffic signal? It will have green, red, yellow, right? So that green tells you something. Okay, you can move forward, and red tells you that you should stop, and yellow tells you that we should be prepared to either stop or move forward. So that traffic lights, we commonly call it lights, but it is actually, to be properly called, it should be called as a traffic signal, right? And where the signal is there. Where is the system? So your brain is the system, right? Or the human body. Your eyes will see the signal. So the eyes will be the input to the system, which is brain. Brain processes it. Brain knows that, okay, if it is red, I should not go forward. So and if it is green, I can go forward. So this can be a very simple example of a signal and system. Like there are signals, and the signals convey some information, right? So the signals will contain some information, and the system, which is the brain, processes it in this example, and then it gives you an action. So the output of the input of the brain is the traffic signals, and the output of the brain is it tells you whether to go forward or to stop and wait, right? So this can be one of the simplest examples of a signals and system. Of course, we'll talk more about electronic signals and systems, or electrical signals and systems, which are linear time invariant systems, power signals, energy signals, periodic, discrete time, continuous time. So that is all more technical and more formal way of discussing signals. But what I want to make a point here is, signals and systems are everywhere. They need not be restricted only to your electronics and communications engineering. They are everywhere. Say for example, okay. So another example of a we can discuss the other things slightly later. So with that, so let me write down some formal definition of a signal, right? So as I just started, signal, so we can write here, a signal is formally defined as a function of one or more independent variables, containing information Just give me a second. Containing information about the behavior or nature of a phenomena. See, the most important things in this is it is a function. It is a function of one or more independent variables, right? Containing information. So a signal will contain some information. Any signal, whether it, okay. So we'll give more examples later, but we'll emphasize these points in a minute. So any signal will contain some information. Information about a physical phenomena, say for example temperature in the summer, like say temperature in the last week or the prediction of the temperature in the next week. It is a signal with your x-axis. Okay, so if we take temperature fluctuations, what is your x-axis? X-axis is days. So days can be July 1st, July 2nd, right? July 3rd, and the temperature can be it is anywhere from, because it's summer, I can start with 25 and it can go to up to 40 or even 44 in some of the places, right? So the temperature can be high or low, right? So this itself, so here this is the independent variable. So as you know, as basically you are all engineers, you know that the independent variable will plot on the x-axis and the dependent variable will plot on the y-axis if it is only one independent variable, right? So for example, speech signal. So when I'm talking, and the speech signal is nothing but variations in the pressure, right? When I talk, the air pressure varies, and then that get caught by the microphone. In the microphone, the carbon granules will vary and the resistance will vary, so the electric signal will vary, right? You must have done basic electronic components and materials where you study about microphone, you study about like some simple electronic devices. So a speech signal will be something like this, like say this is the time and your speech signal can be something like this. Like, of course, I have drawn a random signal, but say this, when the amplitude is high, that means it represents the high volume sounds, and then the amplitude can be low as well. So right, so in this case the independent variable is time. With respect to time we are plotting. So simple, if you take a resistor and a capacitor and a voltage source, right? So the capacitance voltage, it will raise and then it will saturate at V volts. Say this is V volts. This is with respect to time. This is VC. Say this is VC. So it will start rising, it will charge, and then it saturates at V. So this is also, so what I'm trying to say is a signal will have one or more independent variables. So all these examples right now I'm talking about are only one variable, right? Here there is a time, here the temperature fluctuations, it is the x-axis is number of the day, like which date it is, and here again it is time. Okay, so what is the example of a signal having more than one independent variable, or for example a signal having two independent variables, right? So if you can think of, it's easy to think of such a signal. So such a signal is an image or a picture. Say if you take a photograph, Say, for example, just for simplicity, you take a two-dimensional image and black and white. So black and white, two-dimensional image. Then say this is the image frame. Then it has got x coordinate. It has got y coordinate. It has got y coordinate. And you have a picture, something like this. Maybe the hot sun, right? So this picture has got these pixels. So each pixel brightness can be very high or very low, right? So this is a two-dimensional signal. What are the two dimensions? The x coordinate and y coordinate, right? So it's a two-dimensional signal. Similarly, you can have multi-dimensional signals, but in this course, we will be focusing on one-dimensional signals. Signals that are function of one independent variable. Right? Okay. So we'll talk more about signals because there is a lot more to cover. But as I said, this is only an introduction to the entire course. So we have talked about signals and then systems. Like in a simple manner, a system will take the signal as input, and it will produce another signal as output. Or okay, a system definitely its input will be some signal. Okay, and its output can be another signal, a modified version of the input signal or whatever, or it can be an action, right? So for example, if you are traveling in a car, if you are driving a car, and then say you put more pressure on the accelerator pedal will be there. If you press it more, the car will move fast, right? So In that case, so when you press the accelerator, that means you are giving a signal. That signal is pressing the accelerator down. So that signal will act as input to the car engine, and then car engine will move fast. Like will make the wheels move fast, and then it will pick up speed. So there the system output is the response. The system response is making the car move fast. Say and for example, an electronic system, say take a rectifier, either a half wave rectifier or a full wave rectifier. So the input signal is a sinusoid. I don't know whether you studied half wave rectifier till now or not, but what it will does is, if the input wave is sine wave, input wave is AC, the output will be a DC wave. So there the input is a signal, output is another signal, which is a DC signal, right? Or an amplifier. The input is a weak signal, output is a more strong signal, strong in terms of its power or voltage, right? So systems, what we can say is systems. Yeah, so systems respond to particular signals . How do they respond? Sometimes they produce by producing other signals, or some desired behavior. So this is what I was saying. Desired behavior is when we press the accelerator pedal, that means it should move fast. That is the desired behavior. Or it can produce other signals, right? So an amplifier will produce another signal. By taking a weak signal, it will produce a stronger signal. So that that's another example. And then So when we talk about systems, we will restrict ourselves to linear time invariant systems. So let me we will focus in this course mainly on linear and time invariant systems. So these are called LTI systems. So L stands for linear, TI stands for time invariant. Okay, so we'll define all these things more clearly. See, because most of the systems we come across in engineering or in nature are mostly linear, and most of them, like not all of them, are time invariant. Anyway, we will discuss what is a linear system and what is a time invariant system. But more in the entire course, we will be studying only about linear time invariant systems. And we will define what is a nonlinear system or what is a time variant system, but we will never go in depth into studying these systems, right? And when I say we study these systems, we mainly focus on whether the frequency response of the system. So we'll focus on frequency response, on stability of the systems, and the property of memory, whether the system has memory or memoryless, right? And what else? What are some of the other important aspects of a system? So these are the main aspects of a system. So whether the system is linear or not, whether it is time invariant or not, and whether it is a stable system or an unstable system, whether the system has got a memory or not, and most important of all these things is frequency response. We'll study the frequency response of the systems, right? So just to tell you one important thing of frequency response, example of how or why frequency response of a system matters. So if we can, this is a simple example where, right now I guess nobody is using any tape recorders. There used to be something called tape recorders. Your generation must not have seen those things, right? But right now you can use smartphones or voice recorders. So in smartphones, you know that you can record voice, right? When you can record your own voice and you can play back that voice, right? So when if you record your own voice in a tape recorder or for example in a smartphone, because nowadays you don't find tape recorders except in very with old people, you can you try to record your own voice in your smartphone and listen to your own recording. When you listen back, you think that, oh, this is not my voice. Like you won't agree that it is not exactly your voice. It is somewhat modified. But your friends will say, no, it is exactly your voice. So you do that experiment if you haven't done already. And I guess most of you, when you write engineering exams like engineering entrance or MCET or JEE, you must have come across this kind of a physics phenomena. Like, okay, so why do you think that happens? Of course, if it is a face-to-face class, I could have discussed with you, but as it is not a face-to-face class, and then maybe it's difficult for me to know your responses readily. So you understood when you record your own voice and when you play back and listen, you feel that your voice has got modified little bit, but your friends don't feel that. They feel that it's exactly your voice. Why that happens? So why that happens is when you speak, you listen from your internal mechanism. So when you speak, how you hear is you hear through your internal organs, internal audio vibrations. So your voice don't come out from your mouth and then it will re-enter your ears. And that's not the way how you listen to your own voice. You listen to your own voice through the in-body tissues, through inside your body. The sound propagation happens inside your body and you will listen to your voice. The sound won't listen to your voice from outside. Like, but when your friend listens to your voice from the outside, like when you speak, the voice comes out from your lips, right, from your mouth, and then it makes vibrations in the surrounding air, then it will reach your friend's ears, and then that's how he hears your voice. So these two systems are different. Right? When you listen to your own voice, the system is your internal body tissues, your internal organs, through which your sound wave propagates and you listen to your own voice. But how your friend is listening to your voice, the sound waves are coming out of your mouth. They are traveling through the air surrounding both of you. And then it vibrates his eardrums, your friend's eardrums. And then his brain processes it, right? So the system through which your friend is listening to your voice is outside air and the system is different. His eardrums and everything. So the frequency response of these two systems are different. The frequency response of the system through which your friend listens to your voice and the frequency response of the system of your own internal body tissues through which you listen to your own voice, these two frequency responses are different. So that's why you listen your voice differently. So when you record your own voice and then when you play back that voice, you are also listening from outside, just like your friend, right? When you record your own voice and then when you listen back, you are also listening that voice is coming from the smartphone and then it will vibrate your eardrums and then you listen to that voice. So that is slightly different from what you hear your own voice through your internal mechanism. So this is this in fact one of the famous questions asked by Professor Yashpal. Like I don't think many of you know about him. He's one of the most famous physicists India has ever produced, and he used to run a television program called Turning Point. You can ask your maybe elder brothers or your parents. Some of them must be knowing it. This Turning Point science program used to be very famous, and he used to ask very good physics related questions. And then he used to explain some of the natural phenomena. It used to come on Doordarshan. Of course, nowadays Doordarshan, I don't think anybody will watch it, right? Yeah. So anyway, so this example, I like it a lot because it is exactly one example of why frequency response of a system is important. So you say that, say, if you see audio systems advertisements, Bose Audio, Bose is a company and Bose audio systems are very good, they say. Why? Because they faithfully reproduce the signals. Like they mimic listen to a audio or how a system behaves. Okay. So with that, we'll move on. And when we think about systems, we want to do mainly two things. We want to do either of the two tasks. So when I say two tasks, what are those two tasks? So let us see. So one is analyzing a system. So this is Y. So what is analyzing a system? I mean, like, say if you are given a system, then you want to analyze how it behaves. Say a simple RC circuit can be a system, right? Say a resistor in series with a voltage source and a capacitor in parallel with a voltage source, just like the system we have drawn previously. So how the system behaves, if you want to analyze, so what happens when I switch on the voltage source, the current passes through the resistor, the capacitor gets charged up. And after the capacitor fully gets charged up, it becomes an open circuit kind of thing, right? So this is, you want to analyze and see if you are given a circuit, whether a transistor circuit or a diode circuit or so, okay, I'm just talking about here only electronic circuits or any given system, maybe a small machine. You want to see how it works. What happens if you push a mechanical device or whatever, right? So this is called, when you want to understand how a system behaves, how a system responds to a given signal, what will be its output. So you are analyzing the system. You are understanding the behavior of the system, how the system behaves, how it responds, right? So that is called analyzing a system. So if we are given a system, maybe we want to analyze a system, right? So that's one aspect. And another thing, so I'm not writing all these things in words here. Because whatever I'm explaining is very simple, right? It's, there is no math in it. There is no complex concepts here. So analyzing a system, you mean like you know like how the system behaves or responds in what circumstances, what happens. So that is analyzing a system. So the second thing we are interested is designing a system. So what do we mean by designing a system? So we want to design something, some system which behaves in a particular way. Say for example, a full wave rectifier. When we give a sinusoid, we want the output. When we give a sinusoid something like this, we want the output to be something like this. So this is for this input, we want this is the output. Or for example, we want to design a robot which it can be a complex system like a robot which behaves in certain way, which can walk through. Whenever it hits a wall, it will take a turn and then try to find its path. So we will be given specifications of a system. If I give this output, it should behave in this manner. It should respond in this manner. So such a thing is called designing a system. So in analyzing it, so hope you understood the difference between these two. In analyzing a system, you are given a system and you are asked just to understand about the system. Just to understand how it behaves, how it responds, what happens when I give this particular input signal, what happens when I give the other signal, whatever, right? But in designing a system, you will be given specifications. Like you will be asked, okay, if I give a sinusoidal input, it should do this. If I give a ramp input, it should behave like this, right? So this is called designing a system. So we need to do both of these things. We want to acquire tools. We want to understand signals and systems in such a way that we will, let me caution you that we will not be aiming at designing systems at the end of this course, but you will be able to at least understand and appreciate how difficult or how easy it is for us to design a system. And our focus will be mostly on electrical systems, like electrical or electronics, whatever, right? The filters, amplifiers, and such things. Say, in designing system, one example is to enhance to design a system to enhance or restore signals to restore signals that are degraded. So this is degraded. Due to some phenomena. Say a best example for this is communication systems. Say for example, you are in a crowded situation. Maybe you are in a stadium where there is a lot of where there is a lot of noise. People are shouting, and then you want to talk over phone, right? And then your friend at the other end should be able to listen to your voice. So we want noise suppressing mechanisms here. Your cell phone should be able to pick your voice and reduce the ambient noise such that your voice can reach your friend in a much cleaner fashion. So example is communications. And another example is say image processing systems. In image processing, say you have taken a photograph with your cell phone camera or some digital camera or in any camera for that matter. And then you want to enhance the contrast of the picture, right? In nowadays, in many phones, once you take the picture, there will be tools available. It will either increase the contrast or decrease. It will rotate the picture. It will remove the red eye correction, right? So image processing or image enhancement is another example of this. This is all one thing, and then another thing is extracting information so what I'm trying to say is that this designing can be for different purposes, whether you may be asked to design a system to enhance or restore signals that are degraded or to extract information from a signal. So what could be the best example here? Say radar. say you must be knowing something, some at least the basic thing. I'm sure you must not have read about radars, but you know from general knowledge that in defense, in military, there will be something called radar. So radar will send a electromagnetic wave, and then it will hit the target. Target meaning an enemy's aircraft or enemy's tank, battle tank or something, and then it will come back. So when the signal comes back, you want to design a system which can extract whether there is an aircraft on the other end of the signal, and if there is an aircraft, enemy's aircraft, how far it is from your location, right? So that meaning the radar signal has come back. So the antenna has sent an electromagnetic wave. It went and hit the enemy's aircraft and it came back. But from that came back signal, you want to know whether the signal came back after hitting a target. And if it's so, how far is the target? Whether the target is moving towards you or away from you, or whether the target is stationary, right? You want to know all these things. Or for example, another simple example is your ECG. When doctor gets your ECG recording from your heart, he wants to know from that, it will be an electric signal, right? Like some of you must have seen ECG or EEG in a hospital. So there you want to know from that signal, what is the heart rate or how the valves in the heart are working. So we want to extract that information from the signal. So that is another example. So in that case, you are designing a system. And for that system, if you give the radar signal as the input, it will extract information whether there is an enemy aircraft on the other side or not, and how far it is. So another system you want to design, when you give the ECG signal as the input, it should tell you that what are the how your heart is working, right? So this is another example of designing a system. And then just one more example is control systems, which are quite common in factories or plants. A control system is basically you have one system and you want to modify the system behavior. So it is called modify the system behavior. It can be done through by combining two or more systems. So you must be knowing that a computer can be considered as one system, right? A desktop computer, but it has got more subsystems. It has got a CPU, it has got a hard drive, it has got a input output device, it has got a, whatever, right? So it is like by combining two or more systems, you are modifying the behavior of a system or you are making it more so you are modifying the behavior of a system by combining two or more systems or by giving proper input signals. So anyway, these are all the examples of right. Yeah. So, now let's focus more on to the signals. Okay, so just before going, so the introduction is almost at the end. So let me tell you one thing, one very important thing here is S&S, which is signals and systems. Okay. So the signals and systems forms one of the foundational course of electronics and communications engineering. It's one of the most important basic or foundational course. So please remember this, that whether you want to become an electronics engineer, I mean, whether you want to go to VLSI side, microelectronics or analog electronics, or you want to go to you want to become a communications engineer or a signal processing engineer or image processing engineer, whatever, right? So whether you want to go to electronics side or communication side, the signals and systems place is a very, very important course. Unless you understand these concepts thoroughly of what is a signal, what are the different parameters of a signal, how do we represent a signal, how do we analyze a signal, how do we model a signal, right? All these things. And then what is a system? What are the different parameters of a system? What are the different characteristics of a system? And how do we design a system, or how do we analyze a system? Then it would be very difficult. If you are not strong in this course, then the future courses, especially the analog communications in your next semester, and then digital communications course, and then digital signal processing course, all these courses will become very tough for you. Right? So please pay enough attention to this course. And then it's, as I said, it's one of the basic and foundational courses. It's not difficult to understand. So let me tell you that it's not at all a difficult course. I'm not at all trying to scare you out, but it's a mathematical course. I should make it clear that. So it's, we'll make use of mathematics here. It's a mathematical course. So maybe from my introduction, where I'm talking more and more and I'm writing only the sentences, you might be thinking that it's one more kind of a theoretical course where you have to mug up so many things, where you have to write long paragraphs in your exams and all. No, it's a mathematical course. What do I mean by mathematical course is it will be more of a problem oriented course. Like there will be math, simple maths. It's not at all some simple calculus and then simple difference equations, maybe that kind of stuff. But what I'm trying to motivate you is pay attention. It will be very interesting course, and there are excellent books for this. And I try to teach. I try to make it more interesting. But you should also put your hard work so that we together will make it a success. Right, both the teacher and the students, both of them should involve in the course for the course to be successful, for everybody to enjoy. Right, so please take it seriously, and then you can, as I have given you my mail ID, you can always mail back to me about the course, and if you need some changes in the way how I am teaching the course, you can always tell me. So with that, let's move on to, so that's a kind of end of introduction, and then move on to the first topic, which is signals. Okay. Yep. So as I said, we will focus. Just a minute. Yeah. So we'll focus on one-dimensional signals. So we also call it as 1D, one-dimensional signals. Right, and then so let's focus let's start with there are we will be dealing mainly with two types of signals. Some of you must already be knowing what are these two types. So continuous type signals, continuous time. So let's call it CT, continuous time signals. And then discrete time. Signals. See, we have seen that a signal is nothing but a function of one or more independent variables. And then we also said that in this course, we will be focusing mainly on a one-dimensional signal or a signal which is having only one independent variable. Right? So the signal is having only one independent variable. And so that independent variable, if it takes continuous values, we call that as a continuous time signal. So the independent variable generally, mostly we will be dealing with electrical signals in which the independent variable is time, right? Say when you talk about x of t, or okay, you must have till now done v of t. In your network analysis course and all, you must have done a lot of voltage signals and current signals, right? V of t, I of t is a current signal where t is a independent variable, and V of t is a voltage signal where t is an independent variable, right? So this t, if this independent variable is continuous, or it can take any value on the real line, so independent, so the spelling, you just make it correct, independent variable belongs to R. So what is this R? This is the real line, minus infinity to plus infinity. So you know real valued numbers. So these are all real numbers. Right? So say for example, you were maybe a sinusoid where this is t, this v of t, a sinusoidal voltage, maybe your AC voltage signal, right? 230 volts RMS. So this independent variable t is taking values at 1, 1.1, 1.01, 1.12, 1.13, whatever. So it takes continuous values. So it takes values from a real line, where in discrete time, independent variable takes only discrete values. So what could be the example of such a signal? Say for the moment, forget about the electrical signals, but say the stock market index. So the stock market index, every day it changes. It can be some 2000, 2001, like whatever, or temperature across different days. Say so this is the dates, x-axis is the dates, and y-axis is the temperature. Say temperature in Kakinada throughout this summer, May, June, July. So maybe this is May 1, 1, 2, 3, up to like May 31st and then June 1 and so on, right? So the x-axis is taking only discrete values. It is taking only integer values. And the temperature can take any value. It can be 38.9 or 38.7 or whatever. But the x-axis is taking only discrete values. It is number of days. And also say, for example, population in a district across villages. Say you take one district, maybe East Godavari district, and then village 1, how much is the population? Village 2, village 3. Right, there are maybe 100 villages, and each village, what is the population? So this can be another discrete signal. And what is the example of a continuous time signal? In another example, maybe the atmospheric pressure with respect to altitude. So when you are moving above the ground, when you are climbing a hill, right, you can climb 1 meter, 1.5 meters or 1.7 meters, your atmospheric pressure varies continuously, right? Yeah. So what I'm trying to say is, so in discrete time signals, the independent variable takes discrete values, and in continuous time signals, the independent variable takes continuous values. Right. So we also get discrete time signals from continuous time signals. Through sampling. So when I'm saying this, I'm saying only about electrical signals, mainly about electrical signals or electronic signals. So where I say electrical or electronic, both are same. Okay, don't try to confuse between these two, electrical or electronic signals. So we'll study about sampling at a later time, and then some notation that we use here. So for CT, continuous time signals, we use for independent variable, we use T, and we use this parameter. That meaning we'll use like this X of T. So when I say X of T, this is a continuous signal, because T specifies independent variable of a continuous time signal. And also I will indicate by this parenthesis, these brackets, right? And then DT signals, discrete time signals, independent variable, we denote it by N. So N denotes the independent variable, and we use square brackets. So that meaning X of N is a discrete time signal. So T can take any real value. So it takes values from real line, and here n takes values of only integers. So integers are denoted by Z, right? Mathematical letter Z. So integer it can be minus one, minus two, or it can be plus one, plus two, whatever it is. Okay, so yeah. So this is the notation, and with that, yeah. So that means whenever if I say y of n, that means it is a discrete time signal. Say if I say here c of t, that is a continuous time signal, or here if I say v of n, this is a discrete time signal, and I of t, this is a continuous time signal. So these brackets, you should remember that they denote whether it is continuous time or discrete time signals, right? So we'll just quickly touch upon what is the power and what is the energy of a signal, and then we'll continue in the next class. So this modulus of x denotes see, we'll soon define that a signal can be a complex signal as well. Means x of t can have a real value plus an imaginary component. It can have a real component and an imaginary component. So in that case, that's why we take this magnitude. So its energy depends only on its magnitude, not on its phase. That's what we want to say. So and its power. You know all these things, so I can go fast. You know energy and power of a signal. So it's time averaged power. So this is time averaged power is 1 by T2 minus T1 integral T1 to T2 mod x of t whole square dt. Right? So we'll stop here. I guess this is the time for you to, it's almost 3:40. And then we'll continue on Thursday. Right? Yeah. So today at least we could introduce the subject, and then we started with signals, and then we'll be doing more, and I will increase the speed as we go along the course. Right? Okay. So yeah. So I request